all the tears of all his children, just like the ocean our Father holds. He sees the burdens, he sees the struggles and every fear, even my own. So many things I don't understand, but he is God and he knows all of it. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's reaching out, let us run to him. He's got the whole world in his hands. From the borders where the nations war, the battles inside our homes, from the streets where the orphans cry, to the loneliness inside our hearts, in the place where I am, shore to shore, every land, he's got the hope. Baby boy, I felt God. Oh, he was with me then, through the heartache and in the joy. Yes, every tear that we cry, God is with us by our side. He's got the whole world in his hands.
Morning it is too. Welcome to the message, and the message today is occupy until I come. You know, they're the words of Jesus. Occupy until I come. You know, it's nearly a little bit like a maybe like a warfare type theme. Occupy until I come. Occupy. What does it mean? If a house is occupied, it's lived in. Someone's living in it. It's being looked after. Place has been swept clean. Gutters are done. Windows are done. Everything is up to scratch, so to speak. You know, we all know how to keep a house. Sometimes it might be occupy your car. You know, you can tell whether you look after your car or not as to whether there's enough room for you and everything else, plus maybe somebody else to come with you. Some cars are well occupied. But you know, the word that Jesus is talking about today, occupy until I come. Or keep what you've been given. You know, growing up on the farm, if you weren't careful, you've been breeding sheep for a certain amount of time, and you might have a fat lamb property where you're going to fatten lambs and sell them. And if you're not careful and you're not looking after them well, then a fox can get a lamb. You know, you might have some newborn calves, and I've even seen foxes so savage that they're attacking a calf while it's being born. Who's ever had chooks and get out of the chook house one day and you forgot to shut the gate, and here they are, chooks with their heads eaten off. Fox has got them. Well, who's ever been to pick some eggs and there's a snake in the nest? You know, Jesus says, occupy until I come. Occupy. We know how to occupy animals. We know how to occupy our houses. But you know, when we look at this, if you don't occupy something, you lose it. You know, I know there's a law when we were in Queensland. We had a road that ran through the property of the church there. The church was on quite a big amount of acreage. And you know, if that gate wasn't shut every night and it was left open for, say, a month and people kept coming through, we lost our occupation of that, not an occupation as in what you do, but occupying that piece of land. All of a sudden that piece of land went back to the council. And so we had to make sure that gate was locked all the time. I want to have a look at, we know at the moment, the state of Victoria, we don't have to worry about anyone getting out there, it's all locked. But in Jeremiah chapter 29 and verse 7, God speaking to a nation that all of a sudden has lost a lot of its freedom. And reading here, he says, "And seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it, for in its peace you will have peace." For in its peace you will have peace. Pray for the place that it might have peace, and then you'll also have peace. Job seems to operate out of fear, and fear and faith don't mix. You might remember the story of Job. It's one of the first of the scripture written, in actual fact. And we find Job is a guy that loves God, but I think maybe he feared God more than he loved God. And you may remember he was always sacrificing and always doing things in order that his family might be looked after, that God might look after his family. And we know also that God put a hedge around the place. But eventually Job comes unstuck. And I just want to read you this scripture here in Job chapter 3 and verse 25. Well, verse 24 says, "For my sighing comes before I eat, and my groanings pour out like water. For the thing I greatly feared has come upon me, and what I dreaded has happened to me. I'm not at ease, nor am I quiet. I have no rest, for trouble comes." You know, there's a scripture that says, be angry and sin not. You know, there's It's like that we've got to get a bit of grunt in our lives. You know, for too long we've seen Christianity as, well, you know, just love one another and fellowship with one another and share with one another. But you know, Jesus has given us a kingdom, and he expects us to look after that kingdom, and he expects us to occupy until he comes. It's rather an interesting scripture in Luke chapter 12, verse 32. And I haven't quite got the translation of that particular scripture, but this particular translation says this: "And I covenant to give you as my Father has covenanted to give me a kingdom." You know, when you covenant something, is totally different to an agreement, totally different to some sort of arrangement. When you covenant with one another, when you're down, the other one has covenanted to lift you up. When they're down, you have covenanted to lift them up. And you know, as I've always said, the strongest part of your salvation is God. And so here we have Job in this situation where he's let fear come in, and it's nearly like he's put it on himself. Well, maybe I just haven't sacrificed enough. Maybe. And it's like God has said through one of his comforters, Eliphaz, in Job chapter 22 and verse 28. I want to read that scripture to you. Job chapter 22, getting there. Job chapter 22 and verse 28. And he says this to Job: "You will declare a thing and it will be established for you." The King James Bible says, "You shall decree a thing and it shall be established." You know, a decree is something like it's come out of the courts of heaven. "You shall decree a thing and it shall be established for you. So light will shine on your ways." You shall decree a thing. Speak it strong. Allow the Spirit of the living God to come into you. You know, Acts 2:4 was no mistake. When Jesus said, "You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you." I remember this particular situation. I walk out of the back door, and you know, I guess every grandfather or father has done this at some time. We walk out and here's Jana on top of my little shed roof. She's jumped onto the fence and she's managed to jump up onto the roof. And here's Josiah having a go, but he just can't make it. And I hear these words come from Jana. And she says, "Josiah, you've got to get angry. You've got to get angry, Josiah. Then you'll get up there." What words of truth. You know, some Christians are horrified. You know, the Bible says, "Be angry and sin not." You know, God wants to put some spirit into our lives again, so as we can start to rule and reign in this place of Portland. You might say, "Well, bossing everyone around?" No. I'm talking about the things that are holding people captive. People don't change real easy. And I guess in lots of ways, Moses is most probably, well, he was for the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the Arabs, on and on it goes. Either Abraham or Moses are great heroes of their faith. But here we have Moses. God is wanting to do a new thing with Moses. But I believe God wants to do a new thing in us too. So here's Moses in Numbers chapter 20, verse 7. Let's have a look. Drop in on Moses. Numbers chapter 20. Whoops, here it is. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take the rod and your brother Aaron, gather the congregation together, speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will yield its water. Thus you shall bring water for them out of the rock and give drink to the congregation and to their animals. So Moses took the rod from before the Lord as he commanded him, and Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock. And he said to them, hear now, you rebels, must we bring water for you out of this rock? Then Moses lifted his hand and struck the rock twice with his rod, and water came out abundantly, and the congregation and the animals drank. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, because you did not believe me to hallow me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land which I have given them, the promised land. You know, the children of Israel had seen that rod do many things, taken them through the Red Sea, done many, many things, that rod. God said, now it's time for an upgrade. Now it's time where I want you to speak. And what did Moses do? He didn't speak. He gave the people a mouthful and then did exactly as he ever did before. You know, it's time to move out of the old and move into the new. It's time for an upgrade. You know, our world, our words create worlds. You can change a world, or you can change the atmosphere in a place just by your words, by the authority that Jesus has given you. Life is short. Eternity is long. So let's start preparing for it now. The Lord's Prayer. We go through it step by step by step. And then it comes to a line which says, on earth as it is in heaven. On earth, the Lord's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Occupy until I come, says Jesus. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 4, 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4, right over here near the end of your Bible, just before John got around to writing Revelation. Here we go. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. For whatever. Whatever is born of God. I think about one of those kids things that it was like a kids show. I can't think what it was called now, but they talked about being born from above. Whatever's born from above, whatever's born from God, will overcome the world every time. But you know, it takes somebody to mouth it. It takes someone to speak it. And so our job is to speak that word. Speak it into the atmosphere. And what happens then? I just think about this scripture in, I was looking for Mark chapter 1 verse 24. Mark chapter 1 verse 24. Where are we here? Mark chapter 1, ooh, and close. Now there was a man in the synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out saying, let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. You know, when Jesus spoke the word of God, when he spoke to a person that wasn't well, all of a sudden another voice came. You know, we don't realize the power of our words. We don't realize the power that God has invested in every one of us. Invested. He's covenanted it. He says, I've given you a kingdom. And then he says, occupy until I come. Most of us have offspring or friends who are not well, health-wise, relationship-wise, etc., etc. The eye of faith looks past our Goliaths to one bigger, the Lord God Almighty. Imagine Darius, King Darius, that morning as he runs down to the lion's den. He says, Daniel, 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 was your God able to deliver you? Daniel says, yes. Yes, he said, his angels and shut the mouths of the lions. Daniel, 80 years of age. It's time to rise up and say, this far and no further. Excuse me. It's time to rise up and say, this far and no further. The game is up. God's people are starting to stand as one. Stand as one. There's a statement that says, there's nothing like an idea whose time has come. And I guess I've enjoyed that statement over the years, and I've seen situations that have happened in the work, the place that I've been in. I remember at one stage there where we used to have these heavy cartons and things, you know, and in those days, believe it or not, I'm not as old as Moses, but in those days we had no forklifts. And so we just had to get it off as best we could. But there's nothing like an idea whose time has come. And when the forklifts arrived, oh, baby, baby, baby. It was so good. There's nothing like a time, an idea whose time has come. But equally is this. There's nothing like finding your tribe and finding your voice. Deuteronomy chapter 33 and verse 7. Deuteronomy chapter 33, Numbers, Deuteronomy chapter 33 and verse 7. Moses speaking here, and he says, and this Moses said of Judah, hear, Lord, the voice of Judah, and bring him to his people. Let his hands be sufficient for him, and may you be a help against his enemies. In other words, Lord, be his voice, be his strength, and be his hands. Occupy until I come. In Jeremiah chapter 51, verses 25 to 26, Jeremiah 51. Here we are. Jeremiah 51. Verses 25 and 26. Behold, I'm against you, O destroying mountain, who destroys all the earth, says the Lord, and I will stretch out my hand against you, roll you down the rocks and make you a burnt mountain. They shall not take from you a stone for a corner, nor a stone for a foundation, but you shall be desolate forever, says the Lord. You know, the mountains are always symbolic of kingdoms. We're not talking about God's kingdom here. God is talking about the kingdom that is trying to suppress us, trying to push us down, trying to stop us becoming all that he wants. And so he starts to speak about, through Jeremiah, the world's condition. In Zechariah chapter 4, verse 7, God talks to us about how to handle some of these situations. In Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 7. This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel. Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. And then he goes on and says, who are you, O great mountain? Who is this kingdom that's rising up against the living God? Who are you, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you shall become a plain. And he shall bring forth the capstone with shouts of grace. Grace to it. Grace. Grace to it. You know, God gives us the prophecy side. It's our job to speak it. It's our job to declare it. It's our job to decree it. You know, sometimes we can just sit back and say, oh, well, God's given us a prophecy and this is what's going to happen. You know, the intercessors need to take hold of that word and pray it through. Push it, excuse me, push it on through. You know, this is teamwork here. It's not just, oh, well, Steve, you can work on it, mate. No, 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 no. The Bible says we are a body. He wants this body to operate as one. Jesus in Matthew 21, 21 says, you shall say to this mountain, be cast into the sea, and it shall be done. You shall say to this mountain. Like, if you think of that in the natural, it just doesn't gel. But when you realize that that's a kingdom, and Jesus says, all power and all authority has been given unto me, go ye therefore, occupy till I come, then all of a sudden it makes a whole lot of sense. In Luke chapter 18, verse 18, it says, when the Son of Man shall come. When the Son of Man returns, shall he find faith? That's up to you and me. When the Son of Man comes, shall he find faith? I'm believing he's going to find faith. Jesus, come again, Holy Ghost. I pray for your spirit to come and flow through our lives. Quicken us again, God. Lord, like Moses, help us to move on past what we've always known. Help us to move on past. Lord God, come, quicken your people. Lord, as we think about the mess that our state's in, the mess that Australia's in, the mess that the world's in, help us to stand at this time, God, and be those that occupy until you come. Shall you find faith when you come? Too right you will. Amen. God bless you.
Good morning, everyone. This morning we have the honour of speaking with Francine Hayes. Good morning, Francine.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. Francine, I'd like to ask you first, how long have you been a Christian?
Since the age of 13. I'll let you guess how long that is.
Yeah, okay. And how has your Christian life been?
Or would you like to hear how I became a Christian?
Yes, I would.
Well, when we were little girls, I had two sisters, we were the preacher's children, so there was kind of an obligation to become a Christian. And then my mum used to come and pray with us every night until we reached the age of 13, when she said, "You're too old for this now, you need to pray for yourself." And so we each got handed a second-hand Bible, and in the front was a message that says, "Go to page such and such." And we kept doing that, and it led us through the verses that led you through to salvation. So we thought we'd better do it, and we did.
And was that a significant experience for you?
Looking back, it was now. I didn't understand at the time that I was having what you call a closed vision when it happened. I just thought it was my imagination. But as I look back, I can see that I actually was having a vision, but had no idea at the time.
And how has that impacted you recently?
It's impacted me recently because God has been doing a big work in me recently, and He has been wanting to be very intimate with me, wanting to talk with me, wanting to tell me things, wanting me to deal with my past and the issues that have held me back. And I understand that that vision meant I was going into a journey with no support. And it was true, I had no support. And so therefore grew into religion, always trying to fix myself, always trying to make myself better. Mm-hmm. And it's only really recently that God has started to show me clearly that salvation is a gift.
So how would you compare that to what you say is religion?
Religion, I'm never good enough. Religion, I'm jumping higher, harder, faster. Mm-hmm. But with God, I'm loved and accepted just like I am.
Yes.
I long to please Him, not because I am trying to earn His pleasure, but because I love Him.
Yes, and that makes all the difference.
Yes, it does. Yes. Yes.
And you're finding that you're managing that?
I think He's managing it in me. I'm a work in progress, and He is teaching me many things in various ways, and I'm very grateful.
Yes. It's wonderful, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Would you like to leave a message for all people here that will help them?
Yes. You are enough just as you are because Jesus made you and He loves you just like you are. You don't have to try hard. You don't have to jump high. You don't have to run faster. You just need to be the object of His love.
Thank you, Francine. We receive that.
Goodness. From the bush to the beaches, the migrant to the indigenous, though girt by sea, we're not isolated. We're the great south land of the Holy Spirit. Through the fires and drought, no virus could ever hold us down. Because we were made for such a time as this. So the Lord bless you and keep you, Australia, in the name of Jesus.
In your coming and your going.